Hello students, welcome back to your video class. And today I'm teaching you English and our lesson first of 8th class. I hope all of you must have bought the textbook which I told you last time. This is Honeydew, and the first thing I told you something about the reading textbook, why we read the textbook and what are the things we must note down when we study the textbook. Well, when we talk about reading a book, there are a few things we must learn while reading the textbook. And we learn to communicate, writing communication, and then speaking communication. And that's why in the textbook there are many, through many stories, many poems, many articles, essays, biography, autobiographies, the things are presented. So in this book, your first chapter is the best Christmas gift in the world, and this is a small story, or some part of story has been taken in this chapter, written by Michael Morpurgo. So students, as you see the title, just look at the title, the best Christmas gift in the world. You people share the gifts on many occasions. You people give the gifts to your friends, to your relatives, to your near and dear ones on marriage functions or birthday, especially as you are in the school education, so you are a child, so especially you give gift to your friends on birthdays, you give gift to your friend on New Year's, you give gift to your friend on many other festivals, many other occasions. So a thing which your friend give you or you give to your friend, that is not counted with the money, that is not counted with the value of like that, means anything big or small, how that thing adds something more than that money or something else can give you. So that has some special, you know, feeling. I don't think you people lose your friend's gift anywhere. You keep them safe, and now and then you just take out them and you look at them, you call your past memories, you call the things, the incidents, the occasions that gift was given to you. So this is the title, the best Christmas gift in the world. So what can be the best gift for you in the world? It varies person to person. There can be different answers for this. But what we are going to read in this story, this is very beautiful story and very nice chapter. And when we will read, you will come to know how, what is the best Christmas gift, and how this gift is best in the world. You can imagine just what can be the thing which is best in the world for anyone. How can it be? So the author, the writer, tells the story and goes slowly, slowly, and finally, at the end of the chapter, we would come to know what is the best gift in the world for in the eyes of author. So here we go. Before you read the chapter, so you can open your book, keep in front of you when you listen to me, so you can match the lines, you can match the text while listening, and we will read this chapter. So when I read, before I go ahead, before I read, you must note down a few things, that reading is an art, like speaking is an art. Reading is also a very beautiful art, and you must learn to read well in the class. That's why you people are asked to read the chapters in the languages like Hindi, Sanskrit or English. So when you read any language content, must focus on the things. What are those things? Well, I write here, pronunciation. Pronunciation of the word, how to pronounce a word, that is very important, because pronunciation is the soul of any language. If you are not pronouncing the things well, if you are not pronouncing the word well, it would look very awkward to the listener. It would not bring the natural feeling of that beautiful language. So you must watch when I read the chapter, you must watch the pronunciation and rhythm. Rhythm, tone and accent of the word, accent of the word, ups and downs. When we read anything, there is, you know, variation in the speed and the variation of ups and downs. Sometimes you see speed in the sentence and sometimes it goes slow. So it depends on the need of the sentence, it depends on the need of the word and word stress. And expression, word stress. In a sentence, when we want to talk about something and we want to stress, we want to point something special in a sentence, we give stress to that word. Word stress means you give more importance to that word in the sentence, so you can get the attention of the listener to focus on that particular word. So there we need word stress. Oh, in a sentence, you know, word stress is very important thing. Now I have given the stress on the word stress word to catch your attention. So you must know down word stress, then expressions while reading. Body language, you use your body language to make the people understand what you want to say. So this is also very important point. This is also very important aspect of reading. So when you read, you must express, your body speaks, not only your tongue, your eyes, your hands, your whole body speaks what you want to say. So then really you will come to a level of really natural flow of reading, and you will really feel the reading of the English language. So students, I'm going to start. So you must watch all these things when I read. So before you read, there are some dates or periods of the time in the history of the world that are so significant that everyone knows and remembers them. You can see some dates below. So, dates of the history. The story you will read mentions one such date and event. A war between the British and the German in 1914. Can you guess which war it was? Absolutely. You must have studied in SST that in 1914 there was a great First World War between Great Britain or German. So this is the event we are talking about, the World War First. And few dates you can see. So this is your homework. I am not going to tell you today what are the dates and related to the event. So you will find yourself these A, B, C, D, E, F, six dates, and you will mention the date, and in front of date you will mark the arrow, and you will write the date and the related activity or the related incident of the history, what happened on these dates. So you will find this is your homework. And I'm going ahead. In the next class I would tell you the things, but this is your time, your activity to do. So I'm starting the reading of this chapter. You must keep your book with you, and you need not watch on the screen of your mobile, but you need to listen very well. Well, I spotted it in a junk shop in Bridport, a roll top desk. The man said it was early 19th century, an oak. I had wanted one, but they were far too expensive. This one was in a bad condition, the roll top in several pieces. One leg clumsy mended, very badly mended. Scotch marks all down one side. It was going for a very little money. I thought I could restore it. It would be a risk and a challenge, but I had to have it. I paid the man and brought it back to my workroom at the back of the garage. I began work on it on Christmas Eve. And sorry, as you know, this event or something, the story is around Christmas festival. You know, on 25th of December, Christmas is celebrated in India and in most of the countries of the world. So this story goes around Christmas, and this, the author is starting that this was the Christmas Eve. Christmas Eve means the day before, the evening before the same day. Suppose Christmas is on 25th December, so this Christmas Eve means 24 December evening time. Eve means evening time. So the author is telling his experience. He is at a junk shop. You know, junk shop is store, scrap store, where all things are sold. You people sell the old things. And in Bridport, is a place. So he's saying that I spotted it in a junk shop in Bridgeport, a roll top desk which you can say you use for study, in front of you a big table and desk which you keep in your house. The man said it was early 19th century. It was old roll top desk. It's a type of desk. So the man said, the shopkeeper, you can say, it was early 19th century. An oak is a tree which is used for making furnitures. So this table was made of oak tree, and I had wanted one. So the author needed one desk, but they were far too expensive. But he saw some other desks, but they were very far expensive, you know, very far expensive means they were demanding a lot of money for them, and author did not want to pay that much money. He wanted some cheap desk. So this one was in a bad condition, and the author is talking about a roll top desk. So this one was in bad condition, and the roll top in several pieces means several pieces. Roll top desk is made of gluing or fixing the parts of the table, legs, top and all. So it was in several pieces. One leg badly mended leg of the desk. Scorch marks when you scratch, you make the marks while doing the things, and after using for a long time you see the many scorch marks on the top. And all down one side, it was going for very little money because it was not properly repaired, mended, and it had many scorch marks, and it was old, you know, 19th century. So it was going for very little money, very cheap. I thought I could restore it. I will mend it at home. It would be a risk. It's a very great risk, you know, if you buy such thing very old and not looking good. It was a risk, but challenge also. The author thought that I would repair it well at home, but I had to have it. I paid the man and brought it back to my workroom at the back of garage. And the author bought that table and brought at home at the back side of house. He had a garage you use for parking your vehicles and for store purpose. I began work on it on Christmas Eve, and he started working on it. I removed the roll top completely. He removed the roll top. First, he removed the roll top of the table, pulled out the drawers, and there were many drawers both the sides, like you see the drawers in the desk. So he pulled out all drawers. The veneer had lifted almost everywhere. Veneer means you can say it's a type of coat, or you can say we use sun mica we use on the top. Furniture is made, so sunmica is fixed over the top or the sides. So it was a layer of something for decoration purpose. So had lifted almost everywhere, from the table it lifted. pulled out, and it looked like water damage to me. Means because of the water, it was damaged. Both fire and water had clearly taken their toll on the desk. Because of the water or the fire, that cot of the table was damaged completely. The last drawer was stuck fast, and one drawer he could not open, he could not pull it, because it was stuck inside. I tried all I could do to ease it out gently. He tried very gently to pull it out. In the end, I used brute force. And in the end, I used brute force. You know, sometimes when you pull the thing so gently, if you cannot pull, then what you do? You use brute force. With your full force, you pull open. You sometimes pull open the things. So the author did the same thing. I stuck it sharply with the side of my fist, and he hit, and then the drawer flew open to reveal a shallow space there, and it flew open. So the author stuck with his fist. So the drawer flew open, and it was from inside a shallow space came out. Underneath, a secret drawer. Again, in that drawer, there was a secret drawer. Secret drawer. There was something in there. In that secret drawer, there was something in. I reached in and took out a small black tin box. So author found something, a secret drawer in the that main drawer of the desk, and he inserted his hand into the drawer and took out a small black tin box. Small black tin box. Yellow taped to the top of it, and it was taped. You use tape for fixing something, so it was yellow taped to the top of it. Was a piece of lined notepaper. Lined notepaper was pasted on it, and written on it, on that notepaper, something was written there on it in shaky handwriting, not very smooth. Jim's last letter received January 25th, 1915. So this was the date on that letter, and it was the letter was of Jim. Jim is a person in this story. So it was his last letter, and it was received on January 25th, 1915. To be buried with me when the time comes. So it was his last letter, and he thought that when the time comes, it must be buried with me. Means when a person dies, so they bury in the ground, especially in the Christian community. So that letter, to be buried with me when the time comes. I knew, as I did it, and that it was wrong of me to open the box. So the letter was Jim's letter. It was Jim's letter. Because the author brought that, you know, old desk, roll desk from the junk store, and you know, sometimes when we sell the things, so by mistake we forget to clear them properly. Sometimes when we sell the old clothes, so some many things if you have kept in the pocket, it goes away with the clothes. So that way, that letter by mistake, the letter and the tin box was in that drawer, and author took out, he read the title, address. But author thought that if I knew as I did it, that it was wrong of me to open the box, that it was not his box, it would be wrong to open this box because this belonged to someone else. But curiosity got the better of my scruples, feeling that, you know, makes you hesitate something, you know, keeps away you from doing something wrong, that feeling, you know, scruples. So he was very curious to open the tin box, and he wanted to see what was inside. So he was very curious, and it usually does. And earlier he was hesitating to open, but then he just finally, because of curiosity, inside the box, he opened the box. Inside the box there was an envelope. Envelope is used to send letter to other places. One envelope, the address read, what was the address? Mrs. Jim McPherson. The letter was written to Mrs. Jim McPherson, 12th Copper Beach. This is the address. Bridport, Dorset. This is the place. And 12 Copper Beach is a home address. I took out the letters and unfolded it. The author took out the letter and unfolded it. It was written in pencil and dated at the top December 26, 1914. So this was written in pencil and dated at the top. Date was December 26, 1914. The author read the letter, Jim's letter. So far we have read first part of this chapter. In the first part you have known many things about the author, what he brought from the junk store, how he opened the drawers, and how was the condition of that roll top desk, and what he found inside one secret drawer, and how he was hesitating to open that tin box, and finally he opened and he found a letter. The letter was written to Mrs. Jim McPherson. She lives at 12 Copper Beaches, Bridport, Dorset, and the date was December 25th, 1914. So there are two questions from that first part. What did the author find in a junk shop? I think you must have learned it, what he found at the junk shop. Obviously, he found a roll top desk. So you can at least comprehend the paragraph, this chapter. You need not cram the answers. Easily you can keep them in mind. If you enjoy the lesson, if you enjoy the story, you need not learn anything at the end of the chapter. The second is, what did he find in a secret drawer? What do you think had put it in there? So now we have come to know what he found in the secret drawer, and what you would have thought before opening that box, what was inside the box. So you will reread this passage, this paragraph, first part of this chapter, and if you find any difficulty in any meaning, you can underline, and you can consult a good dictionary. we'll continue with the second part because now the author is going to read that letter which he had opened. If you want to if you are also very curious like the author, then you can continue this letter, you can continue this chapter at home, but I will continue it with in your next class. By the time I have given you a homework that in the beginning there are some dates, you will find those dates related to the event and which date is related to which event, and you will write in your English notebook and will send to English teacher. Thank you. Have a nice time.